Everybody, welcome to the Guitar Hour. Hello, everybody.
It's like kids' TV.
I'm Dave Bronze, and over here we have Dan Smith.
Hello.
Yay. The inimitable Tom Quayle.
If you're going to go for a word, make sure you can say it first.
This week we're joined by Dave Bainbridge as well.
Now that does deserve a round of applause.
Hello, and thank you.
Okay, so Dave Bainbridge is joining us today for the Guitar Hour, and I first came across Dave and his music when listening to Iona, and I just started playing guitar around 91, and I went to a festival in 1992. There's about 10,000 people there, and Iona played, and at the time I was kind of a big metalhead and completely converted to listening to kind of more eclectic music, and it was Dave. So Dave's going to be sharing some tips with us today about composition and stuff like that. So yeah,
we'll be playing some tunes as well.
And we're going on tour next week.
Do you want to explain your kind of, I don't want to say relationship, but you know what I mean, like what's going on?
Well, it is a relationship.
What's going on right now with that?
We're going on tour next week, starting rehearsals on Sunday. This is my new band project called Celestial Fire, of which Dave is a big part, playing guitar and mandolin and stuff, possibly some keyboard. These are the first gigs we've ever done as this particular band lineup, and we've been playing a lot of material from my last solo album, which was of the same name, Celestial Fire, and it's sort of Celtic-y, progressive kind of stuff. Really?
Rock?
Yeah. Rocky.
It's very hard to play.
Hobbit metal.
Hobbit metal.
Hobbit metal.
We also have a lovely female singer as well, so it's not all instrumental by any means.
So what's the full lineup?
Full lineup is, I'm playing stunt guitar. Stunt guitar.
Well, that's like a phrase that Steve Vai was named when he was in Dweezil Zappa's band, so it's all the shreddy twiddly bits that...
Oh, okay, yeah. It's basically the bits that I can't do when I'm playing keyboard, but which I would have done, but Dave's doing.
We've got Sally Minear on vocals, we've got Frank Van Essen on drums, who's a drummer for Iona, and Simon Fitzpatrick, who is the bass player for Carl Palmer and Jennifer Batten.
Mr. I can play all of Bohemian Rhapsody on one bass.
Yeah, he is absolutely incredible, Simon. Yeah.
And he's got his own solo spot in the gig as well. I insisted that he should do that.
Absolutely.
And he's, in fact, I've requested a tune from him as well.
Oh, have you?
Yeah, and it's not Bohemian Rhapsody. It's one that...
You have to come to a gig to find out what it is.
It's quite a small lineup considering the size of the music, if you like.
Yeah, you've not seen Dave's setup yet.
this is the mini setup here.
Everybody in the band's sort of multi-instrumentalist, so the drummer, Frank, he plays all the violin parts as well.
Oh, right.
He's an incredible violin player. Sally does
and does backing vocals.
And does BBs and the drums. Sally's the vocals, acoustic guitar, percussion. I'm doing acoustic guitar, slide, mandolin, electric guitar.
Are you doing mandolin as well?
Yeah.
Oh, you did say, yeah, right.
A little bit of mandolin, and Simon's doing bass, but...
He's also going to be doing some Chapman stick, and he said he was going to be bringing his... He was going to be buying a Moog Minotaur to do the bass synth parts on the album.
So the only question remaining is who's playing theremin?
Don't give him any ideas. We already have it. Just from that alone, all the changes are really, for me, challenging because I'm playing electric guitar and I've got to jump onto slide, so I've made myself a little slide that stays on permanently, like a ring. I just got a standard guitar slide and filed it down. I've made a guitar stand so that acoustic guitar's all...
Yeah, I feel inadequate enough, Dave.
I'm just too tight to buy any of this stuff. So lots of changes. So.
Yeah. Then I'm playing electric guitar as well, keyboards, and this thing over here, the bouzouki.
Which sounds stunning. You'll hear the bouzouki later on, actually.
Oh yeah, we'll do something. Yeah, with that.
Yeah. So unfortunately, we couldn't get a full size keyboard in the Guitar Hour studio today.
It's a little small in here. Apologies, guys. We're kind of crammed in here.
So, but we'll be playing. Yeah, if you want to check out that kind of stuff, there's a promo video knocking around on YouTube of some of the tunes with that. But anyway, there you go. Here we are, Guitar Hour. Welcome.
Okay, so we've got, well, these guys have got a list of tunes that they're going to play. We'll probably play a couple of samples from Dave's new record as well, which is Celestial Fire, which is absolutely amazing. What did I do with those CDs? They're up there. Let me just really quickly show you this. This, which is totally out of focus because of the way the camera works, is Dave's new album, Celestial Fire. It's stunning. We'll play you a couple of snippets from it later on. And we're also going to listen to these guys play. I think me and Dave might jam something later
on.
Yeah,
definitely.
I'm not sure what. We'll just make something up. And definitely make sure you catch the tour. What I think we'll do first is it all right, Dave, if you give us a little bit of your history as far as playing goes? Because you went through the education thing. You did a jazz...
I went to school.
You went to school?
Yeah.
So tell us a little bit about that, and then... things that you've done after that, because you played with Gary Boyle for a while, and in Jack various Bruce. Bands, and then Jack Bruce, and then Iona is obviously one of the really big things, and then your sort of solo career as well. So, a brief history of Dave Bainbridge.
Yeah, brief. That's probably quite difficult. Well, I first got into music when I was quite young because I come from a musical family. My mum was an accordion player and an organist and singer. My dad played banjo and guitar,
right.
And they had a family band in the. Back in the late 1940s and 1950s, playing all the big theatres and stuff. So that was with my mum and my dad, and my dad's brother and my mum's sister. They were a musical act called the Bainbridge Trio and Irene. My dad and my Uncle Frank, who was my dad's brother. Sorry, Uncle Lance. That's Uncle Frank's another
Uncle. Musician?
Yeah, he is actually.
Oh,
yeah,
wow.
He's a guitarist. I digress. But they were, like, when they were 15, 16, they came from Teesdale and they were on the radio a lot. So it's quite a big thing, you know, back in the end of the 30s, beginning of the 40s. And my uncle, Lance, he was one of the first people in the country to actually play Hawaiian guitar.
Oh.
It was really popular in the late 30s, 40s. So he had this like lap steel Hawaiian, and he was really, really good on it.
Wow.
So, yeah. In fact, I've inherited his guitar. I've got this, it's an old Selma from, the one I've got from the 1950s. But it doesn't work at the moment. Hopefully one day I'll have it refurbished and try and learn how to play it.
Wow.
So basically all my mum comes from this massive family of seven brothers and sisters, all of whom were or are musicians. And my sister was a singer, she's 8-9 years older than me, and she was in a blues band and a rock band and all-girl band and stuff. So from when I was 8, I was listening to all her record collection, which included like Hendrix albums.
Awesome.
So Jimi Hendrix was my favourite guitarist when I was 8.
Nice.
And I was listening to her blues albums and Beatles and bands from the 60s. There's one band called Vanilla Fudge.
Right.
Who did these really psychedelic organ kind of things. And then she joined a band as lead singer and Hammond organ player, and the band kept the Hammond organ at our house.
Ah.
So like when I was 9 or 10, when everyone was out, I used to sneak in the room and switch it on and play it. And so I got into playing organ quite early on.
Yeah.
Piano was my first instrument. I had lessons from when I was 8. Doing classical stuff, but then as you do, rebelled a bit when I was about 14 when I discovered rock music and guitar. So for a few years I was played in a band when I was 14 in Darlington.
I think there might be a picture on your website.
Oh, that's
that,
right.
That
band was called Exodus. It was a brilliant gig actually. We got, because we were from two different schools, and we got hundreds of pupils came to see us. It was like heaving.
Big audience on the first
year. And then the bass player went off with all the money and spent it on marijuana.
So bass players.
Yeah, so we split up after that.
That was the end of the band, and he didn't share his marijuana.
Yeah, we're good friends now. We've reconnected actually in recent years.
You're right.
After that, I decided when I was like about 15 that music was what I really wanted to do. And I realised that I'd really have to buckle down and get some grades on the piano and everything in order to get into music college.
Yeah.
So fortunately, when I was at sort of sixth form age, about 16, I had this amazing teacher who taught me piano and A-level music, who really saw the potential in the music I was writing. And
this was a school, was it?
This was after I'd left. Well, left school was a disaster because in the last few years, all I wanted to do was play music. So
there was no studying apart from the music.
Well, they wouldn't actually let me do music at school because there wasn't enough people for a course.
That sounds very familiar, actually. Yeah.
So I ended up doing German and yeah.
It was the most musical of languages.
Yeah. yeah. So it wasn't really until I got to sixth form that I began to study music seriously, right. And yeah, my teacher. He was brilliant. He got me from like grade 5 to grade 8 in the space of 2 years. So.
Right.
And then I was able to apply, because I wanted to do not just classical music, but something more contemporary. Mm-hmm. So at the time, Leeds College of Music offered the best course that was non-classical. And so I went there and studied jazz for 3 years, which was great fun.
And it was Leeds College of Music was quite different by then. It was in a different building because I was there in 99 to 2002, and the new building had just opened. So you were in a different building, and it was diplomas, wasn't it? But it was a 3-year course.
Yeah,
so it was a fairly substantial set of studying.
Yeah. It wasn't classified as a degree course at the time. It was called a diploma in light music and jazz.
Yeah, I saw that light music.
Light music.
Yeah, whatever that is.
So. Musicals.
But the good thing for me was that you had quite a lot of the time on the curriculum where you could do your own thing.
Right.
So I spent loads of time in the recording studio learning how to use the gear and record lots of my own stuff.
Right. So you found that whole process very interesting. Obviously, Your writing, which we'll get onto later, the harmony you learn obviously has become very useful to you. I don't know if you even think that way, whether you just right by ear, but I mean the harmony has obviously been very beneficial.
Yeah, I did learn about harmony and stuff from the age of 16.
Yeah.
And that. So yeah, I mean what was great about the teacher I had then was he really broadened my horizons into discovering composers like Debussy and Stravinsky and Mahler and Erik Satie and so I really got into, because I was also doing art at the time, A-level art and art history.
Right.
And I really loved the whole Impressionist kind of period. Mm. And it was similar in music as well, because the music had, at the time, had a similar quality to the painting.
Yeah.
In that you suddenly went from like detailed realism to capturing an impression or a feeling of a place. Mm. And like the Impressionist artists would just set up an easel somewhere and paint really quickly. Mm. And the idea wasn't to get detail, but was to capture the feeling and emotion that they felt looking at something.
Yeah.
And that same kind of thing was prevalent in music with people like Debussy.
Mm.
And I just loved that whole idea. And I think the music I've been writing since has been had that sort of vague quality, really, trying to capture not maybe detail, but sounds and things that would conjure emotions, a feeling of a place or something like that.
And I guess in terms of, before I get you guys to play something shortly, Iona, because Iona's been a massive success for you. So tell us a little bit about Iona, how it formed and when it formed and how that kind of, because I was saying to you earlier on, I mean, interestingly, I know so many people who are into Iona. And I do this guitar retreat Spain in Spain, funnily enough.
They don't live in York, do they?
No, they don't. I don't know. Actually, they might.
Gig next week, which hasn't sold many tickets yet.
Well, I'll let them know. Maybe they'll come over. But I do this guitar retreat in Spain, and we're in literally the middle of nowhere. And I go into their music room where they've got the CD player and all the CDs, and there's every Iona album that's ever been released in there, I believe. So, you know, very widely listened to, and you toured all over the world with
Iona.
So tell us a little bit about that.
Well, yeah, I mean, when I left college, my whole aim was to have a band that I could play my own music. Yeah. So the first thing I did was form a band. It was called Plan B.
Right.
It was with my sister singing. And the music was, it was almost like, the music in Plan B, this was like right back at the beginning of the 80s, was almost like a prototype of what was to come in Iona 8 to 9 years later, in that it was partly instrumental, long involved pieces with vocal sections, and then songs interspersed with that, with the vocals, and some improvisation and that. That band lasted about a year, and I spent loads of time writing music, and we rehearsed every week. But it was like anything progressive at that period in time, when you just had punk and everything, it was just a waste of time.
Right.
And we just couldn't get any gigs. So
right.
anyway, after that, I just looked for other people to play with and joined Gary Boyle's band, playing jazz fusion, playing on keyboards.
Check Gary Boyle out, by the way, guys, if you've never checked him out.
Great.
Fantastic guitar player.
And then, like, for the next 7 or 8 years, spent loads of time writing music for media, and then playing with different artists, including Jack Bruce and Gloria Gaynor, who did Iron
Gloria
Gaynor.
A friend of ours is on, or has been on tour with Gloria Gaynor very recently.
Yes.
Playing guitar, yeah, Tony.
Oh, right.
Don't know if Tony's watching, but if you are, hello, Tony.
Yeah.
Hi, Gloria.
Yeah, I played keyboards with her for a little bit. Then, it was in 1989 that Iona formed, and it was originally myself and a woodwind player who played saxophones and exotic wind instruments of all kinds, called Dave Fitzgerald.
Yes.
And we were looking, we're playing with this singer-songwriter called Adrian Snell. I know this is supposed to be the potted version.
No, it's fine, it's fine, it's great.
So we were playing with Adrian Snell, this singer-songwriter, and basically it was the three of us were on tour, me, Adrian, and Dave Fitzgerald. And we had loads of time in sound checks for me and Dave just to jam and stuff. And we realised we had something brewing, that, you know, some music that seemed to be working, gelling between us. And so Iona came out of that, and we did one gig just instrumentally, and then decided that really we needed a vocalist as well to fulfil the sort of musical vision. And we'd already met Joanne from a recording we'd done. So Iona then became a three-piece for a while, and we sort of basically hired in bass and drum players. And it was Nick Beggs, who was
Kajiku.
He plays Steve Wilson now.
Nick plays Chapman's stick as well.
He plays bass and
Chapman's stick.
Yeah, he's with Steve Wilson and Steve
Hackett. Yeah.
It's him and then Terrell Bryant, who's played with John Paul Jones.
Right.
That became the band. By the time we did the second album, that was the five-piece band. Things just developed from there, really.
So I've got to ask you later on, I'll let you guys play something, but I've got to ask you about the Celtic influence as well, because doing the jazz thing and, you know, obviously been to rock and Debussy and all this kind of thing.
Yeah.
So I won't get you to answer now, because we'll get you guys to do a little bit of playing, because we'll intersperse it, but I am very interested in that kind of Celtic influence, because my parents were very into Iona, and it was because of the kind of folk and Celtic influence, so we'll get onto that later. But what are you guys going to play first?
Well, we could play the opening section of Celestial Fire, perhaps. Obviously, we've not got the whole band here, and I haven't actually got any drums or bass on the computer here, just some keyboard parts and a cowbell.
Yeah, I mean, remember, guys, this is totally live, so, you know, this is not kind of like... audio-wise, we're running through a mic here, so apologies it's not... If we play some stuff from Dave's album later on, which this is, by the way, but obviously the live version, if we play some stuff from Dave's album, we'll run it in stereo so you get really good quality sound. We're running through the mic here, so this will sound good, but, Don't expect incredible sound quality, just incredible playing. Sorry, guys. Okay, so this is the opening of Celestial Fire.
Yes, this piece is actually, I think, the longest one on the whole album. It's like 15 minutes long.
Yeah.
It goes through loads of different sections. But this first section, I wanted to capture real excitement and the idea. Well, the piece is partly about sort of creation and things... the firmament, celestial firmament.
Wow.
So, big subject. So when you hear this with the drums, I mean, the drums are like really explosive on this. But at the moment, it'll just be a click.
And if they want to come and see it with drummers, they can come and see you.
You can come and see us live next week.
Okay, so I'm going to be riding the gain on the mic a little bit, guys. So fingers crossed, we'll get this sorted for you as quick as possible. So yes, whenever you're ready, guys.
Okay. 2 bars, I think.
Thank you. think the word for that is epic. Amazing, guys. Absolutely amazing. Sounds fantastic.
It's a bit weird doing it without any drums, to be honest.
Yeah, just a click. But again, if you want to hear it with the drums, you guys can go and check them out in York. What day? By Wednesday? Next week?
Thursday. Next week.
Yeah, Wednesday in Bilston, West Midlands.
Okay, so how many dates are you doing?
Just the three. So we're doing Bilston. The Robin 2 in Bilston on October 1st.
Okay.
September 30th.
September 30th.
Make sure you turn up on the right
York.
Day.
York, yeah.
Yeah, it's probably the Led Zeppelin tribute band or something. Knowing the Robin.
York, Fibbers, the day after October 1st. And then we're playing at Summer's End Proc Festival on the 2nd.
At Chepstow,
yeah.
South Wales.
And obviously is that all on Dave? Is it DaveBainbridge.com?
DaveBainbridge.com or DaveBronze.com.
DaveBronze.com. If you just look on there under Celestial Fire Tour dates.
Brilliant.
So, yeah.
Okay, so let's get just briefly back to that Celtic thing. I don't want this to turn into an interview, by the way, so we can talk about whatever. But
yeah,
I am genuinely interested in this because it's a really big influence for that band, I would say.
Yes.
William Pipes and, you know, it's a very modern Celtic sound, but with the drones and the especially the way, we talked about this very briefly before we went on air, the way you play the guitar as well to me sounds almost horn-like. Like a traditional kind of Celtic horn, not like a saxophone.
Yeah.
Does that make sense?
Yes. Yeah. I mean, when I was a teenager, I was listening to all the rock stuff. Then I got into the classical stuff as well. But I was also listening to a lot of folk bands at the time. There was a band from Ireland called Horselips.
Right.
Who I remember, there was an album. What was it called? Book of something or other. Yeah, I'm
not
sure.
The Book of Kells.
It wasn't the Book of Kells, no.
was it David Spillane on that?
No. But anyway, they were basically a rock band, but they used Dylan Pipes. And, they had that sort of, they were from Ireland and had that influence. They were the first band I heard that combined rock and traditional folk influences and instruments.
Because it works incredibly well.
Yes. So I was listening to them and I was listening to people like Clannad and Alan Stivell, who was a fantastic Celtic harp player, Boys from the Loch and Planksty.
Right.
That was another whole area of music that I was interested in. And I remember trying to write some kind of jig kind of things when I was probably 16, 17. When it got to the time we were doing Iona, I really, I was a huge Clannad fan and wanted to try and combine the sort of ethereal side of Clannad's stuff with the sound of Pipes. And I know when we were doing the original Iona album, we didn't have anyone. It was like myself and Dave and Joanne, but none of us actually played. Well, Dave plays low whistle, which is an Irish instrument, but he doesn't play any kind of pipes.
Okay.
But I had the idea that that should be really a really key sound in the whole sound of Iona. Mm. And I was doing a TV thing for Tyne Tees up in Newcastle, and Catherine Tickell, Northumbrian pipe player, was on the same programme. And it was the time we were just recording the album. So I actually talked to her about the possibility of her playing on the album. And I think she was up for that. But then, probably a week or so later, I was actually doing a blues gig in Wales with a band. And at half time, the sound engineer was played this amazing music, which had the sound of Illan pipes, the Irish version of pipes, on it. But it was in a rock context.
Right.
And I'd never heard anything like it. I thought,
right,
this is amazing. What is it? So I asked him and he said, it's a band called You Slosh. I was doing
you
sound
Slosh
for them. Yeah,
right.
Bizarre name.
Yeah.
So I thought, I've got to find out about them. And I think he actually, because he'd done sound for them, he actually had a contact telephone number, because this is pre the days of the internet.
Yeah.
We're talking 1990, I think this was. And I managed to track down the drummer and asked him about who the pipe player was on the on their album, and would he be interested in playing on our album. And it turned out to be Troy Donnelly.
Mm.
And it also turned out he lived in York, and I was in, at the time I was living in Otley, which so York is only
just
20
a couple of minutes
away.
Down the road from here.
And he didn't even have a telephone at the time.
Right.
So
not
so
an
I
easy
think,
man to get hold of.
No, but. I think I had to write to him or something.
Right.
Ridiculous.
To send a raven.
Yeah.
Send a raven.
You know, it's so, I mean, no mobile phones or anything.
No, of course,
So the first time I met Troy, he agreed, I think through the drummer, to come and do the session. So the first time I met him was in this basement of this house in Leeds. It was a studio. I played him the tunes. He hadn't heard any of the music. And he just took a listen and played along. And it just sounded fantastic.
Yeah, it's
a
great
just
sound.
Amazing. I mean, Troy was only 23, I think, then.
Mm.
So he was still quite young. And he was still in Hugh Slosh.
Best name ever.
Yes. So I thought, you know, we've got to work together again at some point. And then Hugh Slosh split up, I think, in about 1992.
Mm.
So after that, Troy started doing the occasional gig with us and played on the next Diana album, Book of Kells. And it was on that album that we discovered the sound of the electric guitar and the pipes in unison and how playing the same tune on those two instruments, or sometimes with a low whistle dubbed on as well, just sounded really majestic.
Mm. There's certain combinations of instruments that just work like bass and piano in the low, like an acoustic upright bass and piano.
Yeah.
Just this woody kind of amazing sound. And
the
pipes and guitar are kind of similar. But you're, I've noticed that there's an Iona video on the on your website, I guess it's on the Iona website as well, and there's a synth. And you're just playing over the synth pad, and the way you play with the bar, and also the attack you've got. Sometimes you play with fingers, I guess, in order to get the right attack.
Oh, yes.
For that kind of thing.
Yeah.
I mean, I don't want to put you on the spot, but what can you just show us a brief kind of thing that you might do, just kind of, because it's a really interesting way of playing.
So I was going to ask, did you have to make, like, between the two instruments, did you have to both make allowances to make the phrasing sort of, or is it just the guitar trying to sound like a pipe? Because I imagine, from their point of view, I mean, on the instrument, but they've only got a certain range of stuff, whereas having, you know, electric guitar, you've kind of got, there's more tricks you've got to sound more like them than them trying to meet you in the middle.
That's true, yeah.
I mean, well, there's two things, I suppose. The first thing we started to do was play tunes together that were almost sort of based on jigs or reels kind of thing.
Yeah.
So a unison, quite often quite fast, but not always. And in those instances, I'd be really listening to Troy and seeing what he did, how he bent notes on the pipes.
I imagine those are hard enough to lay out.
Yeah.
Because, I mean, they've spoken briefly about trying to play any kind of jigs or reels and stuff, and because they're not necessarily written for guitar, the way they end up lying on the instrument is just horrific.
Yeah, it can
be. It's horrible to try and play.
Yes, it can be. But it took me ages to just listening to what he did over and over again. And we played together for 15 years in Iona, full-time sort of in the band. And over that time, I think we got used to...
Things have got to rub off after...
The kind of way he played and that. And quite often then we'd, you know, there'd be like maybe a phrase at the end of a thing we'd been doing in unison that we'd just instinctively play the same.
Yeah, it becomes kind of automatic after a while because you hear the phrase that way.
And you've got to choose where you... Pull-offs and things are going to go, and where you know, where you're actually going to pick and where you're not going to pick.
But what's been great about doing that is that it's got me out of like blues shapes, really.
Being a guitar player.
Guitar player.
Well,
you know, exactly.
You hear that's a very guitar-y way of playing something.
Yeah, for sure.
Yeah.
Should we do the drone one?
Yeah, could. Yes.
Great.
Sure. Okay. There's... This is a piece, an old Gaelic hymn tune that Troy actually showed me how to play. When we did it in Iona, I played keyboards and he played this on low whistle. But after he left the band, then I thought, why not try it on the guitar?
Mm.
So, this one demonstrates some of the kind of, I'm trying to sort of play it as though I was a pipe player, island pipe player, really. I use sometimes I'm playing with my fingers to get that kind of sound. Mm-hmm.
gives you as much as you can possibly get on the guitar, more of the attack of, not the soft attack of blowing.
Yes.
But if someone blows quite hard, that kind of attack, I'm really probably not making a lot of sense. But the attack is softer, but there still is attack. You're not swelling into the note.
Yes.
But it's not the same as if you get have a pick attack.
Yes.
There's a different kind of feel to it. Are you using your thumb? Or are you using finger?
Oh, so the middle finger. Middle finger,
And you're right under the string and giving it a good...
Yeah, I'm sort of plucking it upwards, I suppose. Yeah. But no, sometimes I'm using my thumb.
Those are very kind of horn-like as well.
Yes.
Bend, release, push back up a little bit, and then release again.
Yes.
Very kind of the trills as well, all those kind of things that are very the little nuances of Celtic music that are very important.
Yeah. I mean, actually, when you like, when I sort of record pipes quite a lot, as you can imagine, and when you see the waveform on on the computer, it basically it's square like that. You know, it starts because it is very hard at the beginning.
Yeah.
On the pipe, on the Ulam pipes. And then it stays, it's quite a sort of square wave. Well, a square wave, is it?
Yeah. I know what you mean, though. It's not.
Yeah.
It's not doing.
So actually, it's quite a similar sound when I've got quite a lot of distortion on.
Yes. It sort of cuts the edges off. And...
So when you hear the two together and you pan one left and one right, which we often do, it's sometimes quite difficult to distinguish between which is the pipes and which is the guitar. Which I think is quite a nice thing because it's got this sort of homogeneous sound.
There's another thing as well. I think when you play with instruments that can sustain notes for a long time.
I was just going to say, have you ever used like a sustainer or anything, or like an ebow or anything like that? Or?
Yes, in fact, that's one of the reasons I got this guitar because it's Fernandez with the built-in sustainer. So.
Listen to that.
Don't look at the guitar.
Because the other thing I was going to say was, you don't like. I've recorded a few things with sax players, for instance, and they sustain notes a lot longer than you do. You don't think as a guitar player. So obviously, you have to come in at the same. If you're phrasing identically on a record, but you have to make the note die at the same point as they do, or it sounds kind of odd. And so you've got double the amount of kind of, if you like, thought process involved. Especially when you're recording live, I don't think it matters so much because there's always going to be some give and take. But on a record, if you're playing a doubled part with a pipe player, you have to really shape the phrase exactly the same way as each other, I would imagine.
Yes, and with the pipes as well. I mean, basically, it's the note is on or off. So, the only way Troy or anyone who plays pipes can fade out a note like a saxophone is actually on a volume pedal, because it just stops.
Yeah.
Really?
Yeah, and because the way it works is he's got like a sack of which he pumps with air with his
it's a lovely instrument, isn't it?
Ilan is Irish for elbow, so they're elbow pipes. So you're constantly pumping air to try and keep the same pressure.
Right.
So unlike the saxophone where you're blowing in and you have to stop for breath. A note on the pipes can go as long as he's...
As long as you've got the elbow grease to...
similar to a bagpipe kind of setup.
Exactly, I mean, it's very similar, except that with the Ilan pipes, there's the more notes to the scale.
Okay.
And you can play drones as well, you can play your own accompaniment.
Yes, that's right.
Well, I guess that's part of where the a modern sort of sound would be a synth drone, and then the guitar over the top, which is emulating the original sound of a drone plus... a pipe, and the pipe would, I would imagine, be like a bagpipe, is just slightly out of tune with itself as well. It's a kind of slightly, it's not, say, I mean, a guitar is slightly out of tune, but the bagpipe's got a slightly interesting kind of out of tune kind of sound as well. Are the Ulam pipes the same?
Not quite, no, it's a bit more of a pure kind of note on there.
Right.
But there are drones, there's a set of drones, and you use, really weird. I've watched people play. I think you use part of your arm to change, or one of your elbows to actually press these keys down to change the notes.
What? How many? Because I've never really seen the instrument. But how many? What's the sort of range? Is it they're not sort of they're not like in a key as such?
Yes, sort of. There's Martin, who's in Iona, who plays pipes now, has got two different chanters. So there's one pitched in C and one pitched in D.
Right.
And basically you can get all the sort of related keys nearby. So if you've got the C chanter, like C, F, and G.
By bending the notes, then you don't.
Yeah, because you can bend notes on there. But as soon as you get to like maybe more extreme, like E or I don't know, F sharp major or something like that, or B major, then it
like
becomes
four or five sharps kind of.
Yeah, it's not really possible.
Right.
So actually, that's one thing I've when because particularly with Troy, we used to do a lot of just spontaneous improvisation. And I'd have to remember not to go to certain keys. otherwise it'd be impossible for him to
Yeah,
play.
I think we're going to try some out later on. You've got a bit more freedom, so you can...
Yes.
Well, within reason.
Yeah. But, yeah, so Martin has two different chanters, which is just part of the pipes, that he can quickly switch on a gig.
Mm.
So he goes from the D to the C, and then
right.
it opens up a few more
awesome.
Key options.
Fantastic.
Yeah.
Okay.
Should we play some
Yeah, I was going to say, play another one.
Shall I play a bit of this... Angel of God, this
yeah.
So, absolutely.
Yeah.
Is this the one with the drone then?
Yeah. No.
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 Yeah. No. He knows. I don't know.
Yeah.
Okay.
So I'm just on a sort of generic, very distorted sound.
Yes.
At the moment. But
sorry
it,
about that.
Yeah. It's alright.
Dave's using my rig as opposed to his own.
So.
Gorgeous, absolutely gorgeous.
Another thing I was just thinking about there, the pipes quite often, and on the whistle, when you hear those traditional players, they'll tail off a note in pitch at the end of the of the note. So that's another thing that I've sort of tried to incorporate from.
Now, are you talking about the dip of the bar, or are you talking about the actual volume?
No.
Yes.
That kind of
thing.
Yes.
Yeah. So. The thing is that the guitar, when you run a load of reverb and delay, it's. I think this is one of the times where you're allowed to have a load of reverb and delay and get away with it.
Yeah.
Because it just adds so much to the sound. It's so beautiful.
Yeah.
You've got the space for those single notes.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
I run two delay. I stack two delay tip.
I'm a delay fiend. By the way, Dan, have a. We've got. Okay. We've got my partner Cheryl has made these ridiculous buns down here. So, have yourself, guys.
Well, go on then,
I'm not going to have one, but I don't eat sweet things, but I've been told they're very good.
I was thinking one of the things that I'm looking forward to the gig is playing some of the sort of traditional reels that are really, really technically challenging.
Very difficult guitar.
And just because a lot of the position shifts don't fall under the fingers at all. And Dave has a real love for doing these faster than should be possible.
It's so, a thing like what Andy Wood said about his album where mandolin, the stuff that he was playing on mandolin falls under the fingers, but then trying to put it on guitar is horrific. It's probably the same the other way around.
Mm.
I imagine guitar, like I've I was trying to play that before, and that's kind of everything's upside down.
Yeah.
So you kind of the stuff you normally play doesn't really work.
It's kind of
one note out all the time. You know,
and because the guitar's so visual, you get used to certain shapes.
Yeah, exactly.
Hands,
and what Dave then likes to do is to put them in odd time signatures. So we're doing one reel in 11/8.
Yeah,
11/8 with a few songs in 15/16.
So
stuff like that,
here's a question: compositionally, are you just being awkward and lopping a 16th note off the end of the bar, or are you actually hearing it like that?
Absolutely not. No, it's always done. Well,
how dare you?
Yeah,
I'm thinking of that.
Yeah, I know. Yeah, I feel quite guilty sometimes about some of the stuff I'm asking you to play, but. I mean, there's a lot of stuff, you know, when you think, when people talk about progressive rock music, of which I suppose we're in that general genre. And they think of odd time signatures. And it almost like something that's just done because it's hard to play kind of thing. But for me, it's done for one of two reasons, really. Well, one, because it's a good groove in whatever... time is. I mean, with that 15/16 I came up with that riff. And actually, when I played it, I had no idea what time signature was, and it was only really when I recorded it and
had to figure it out,
analysed it, and did a sort of guide drum part, I realised. But I just thought it was a really nice groove.
That's fun to play.
Yeah. But and then other times,
did that not sound very convincing?
It sounded very convincing. Keep it in your bum.
Yeah.
But other times, there might be, like, there's one piece called For Such a Time as This on the new album. And there's quite often, a lot of it's in 4/4, and then there'll be a bar of 3/8 or something thrown in, or a bar where there's a beat missing or a beat added. But that's done purely for compositional purposes. Like, say if you're, I don't know, if you're in a particular key and you wanted to have a key change, and you want it to be dramatic, and you're just in 4/4, it's sort of almost quite obvious that it's going to happen on the first beat. But if you bring it forward and miss a beat out, it comes in sort of unexpectedly.
So it's a tension-building device.
Exactly, or an anticipating kind of device if you have a bar that's longer than you expect.
Okay,
There's a tune we could play, actually, really, Love Remains. It's 4/4. But the beat hardly ever happens on one.
Right.
So maybe, should we play just a quick blast of the intro for that? Is that easy? No, I mean off the CD.
Oh, right.
We won't get to play on this
keyboard.
Yeah,
it's like a 4-octave kind of 5-octave piano thing. We've only got 3 octaves or something.
Love Remains?
Yeah.
Yeah.
So you just want the intro from this?
Yeah.
Is that all right? Yeah? You're going to do it?
Go.
We'll be right back.
So incredible. I think that's all it's for.
Yeah.
But it's just anticipations all the time, so it gives the impression of moving across the bar lines, which is something I really like to do do a lot. And again, it's I suppose it's that sort of impressionist way of thinking that things remain fluid sort of thing rather than fixed down.
So that kind of thing, I always find this interesting. I always ask people this when they compose because it's pretty complicated. Are you, that section, did that come out in one session or did you have to work really hard at it? And then when you got it, how easy was it to program the bass parts, the drum parts and come up with all the bits? Because that seems like a nightmare to me.
Yeah, okay, well, I mean, this is a, like 13 and a half minute long piece and it goes through different sections and everything, vocal sections. And but it started just with the, I don't know if we've got a piano sound, just like the first minute basically of that piano idea, which I thought was quite nice.
Right.
And then I left it for a couple of years because I didn't think it was going to be an
idea. It sits on the hard drive.
Yeah.
Wow.
But then when I started doing the album, I thought it'd be nice to do something with that. And so I developed, there's like a few things in there. There's like an arpeggio figure and then a sort of fourths kind of thing. So I decided to try and use those two aspects and do loads of just variations on those particular ideas.
Mm.
So like changing the underlying harmonies and kind of thing. Sorry, what was the
question? No, I was just wondering about, so when you've composed it,
oh yeah.
So obviously you get the piano part.
Yeah.
Then, because piano is the main instrument for you, and obviously guitar as well. And then coming up with, are you actually sitting down and writing a bass part and a drum part as well?
Well, I did guide. I mean, all the bass and the drums on there are real.
Oh no, I don't mean that. I mean
but,
in the initial demo.
Yeah,
stage.
In the initial stage, I put some guide parts down, which were fairly. I mean, not as obviously complicated as what Colin played on there, but fairly much in that sort of ballpark.
And are you writing charts out for the guys, or do you give it to them and say, good luck, use your ears, go for it?
No, well, with the bass, I pretty much wrote everything down. And then there were bits where it was exact, like on that opening.
Mm. With the bass parts, do you match anything up with the left hand on the piano, or do you...
Yes,
do you
on that bit, there was quite a lot of stuff, which is why it had to be pretty much exact.
Yeah. Okay.
But then there were other sections where I knew that Randy, who played the bass, would be able to come up with his own kind of thing, so I'd just give him chord symbols for...
Because it's always one of my bugbears when people ask you to do a little bit of session work and this hideously complex thing arrives and there's no chords, no chart, nothing.
I mean what I sent to Colin was basically the MIDI files, which had all the bar changes on everything, rather than actually try and write out a drum part,
which is almost better, of course, because then you can stick it in the sequence to slow it down and come up with parts and so on and so forth.
I just said which bits need to have accents on,
right,
and then the rest, you know, you could do whatever you want.
Cool. Nice.
So one thing that I've always loved about the music you write is, like, melodically it's really strong, and one thing that's really clever that I've really learned since having to learn the tunes is you can have the same melody and the melody will repeat four times, but almost the cleverness is in the harmony, so the harmony is always varying, like, rhythmically and it's never the same chord sequence, right? Because one of my bugbears about a lot of modern sort of guitar instrumental stuff is that it sounds like someone's put a drum track on, play four chords they really like, and then
it's like
and
a
it all just
copy and paste kind of thing.
What's amazing about what you do is the melody will be really quite straightforward, but often the thing that makes it sound amazing is the cleverness of the harmony that never really sort of settles underneath.
Mm.
Also makes it really challenging for me to remember as
well.
Because we'll go for like 30
That's what
keyboards.
That was all leading to, wasn't
it?
Yeah.
So I'm getting it all off my chest now.
On
tunes like Brendan's Return, for example, like you have like certain things, but then the ending is always different chords, like on every repeat.
Yeah, I mean, there's a reason behind that. It's obviously not for it to sound the same all the time, but for everything to develop and take unexpected twists. And that
you have, with different endings, you've got the option of, like, obviously you're saying it's sort of repeating and stuff, but you've kind of got the option of, is it going to repeat or is it going to go somewhere else? Because if it's like a sort of like what we'd maybe call a turnaround, that's slightly different each time. You never know if it's going to go that way or, you know.
And because rhythmically as well, it's not just like always on the beat, there's loads of pushes and stuff. It feels like it's really floaty, so it's almost like a rhythmic kind of tension that's going on that we've talked about.
Yeah, I mean, also it's like on that tune, that end section is a guitar solo after the tune's finished. So just changing the chords around gives me different options of notes to play as well. Even if it's just one chord that's changed, that can suggest a different scale or a set of notes.
So that leads to another question, which is a total music geek question. If you're writing, say you have a melody, you reharmonise it four times, let's say you were going to improvise over that section as well. When you're improvising, are you doing chord scale associations? Is that how you're thinking, or are you going more by ear these days? As in, has that stuff become instinctual, you don't have to think about it anymore?
It's a bit of both, and sometimes it's thinking about notes that will create tension and resolve. So I'm always thinking about, like, say if we've got, if you play D, something like that. So the obvious notes to play over that would be the notes of the chord, if it's D minor. So I'll try and find notes that will maybe clash a bit, and then to create some tension, and then resolve. So maybe I might, if you were playing a D, I might start something like this. So I'm actually on the sixth, the B, going up to a minor seventh, and then finally resolving onto a chordal note. So having a non-chord note. Creates that tension, and then you have that release. So, I might have something like this, which is, again, it's just going from the fourth to the third, but because the fourth isn't actually a note of D minor, it just sounds a bit more interesting to me, and it creates a bit of tension that you can then resolve.
Absolutely, and
then if it's just a fifth kind of thing, you can also play about with major and minor tonality. Yeah.
For the interval way of thinking,
yes,
we sort of half on about all the time instead of thinking in sort of scales and stuff all the time. You can just thinking in individual.
Yeah. Oh, the dog's making her escape.
Yeah,
Spratty, what's the matter?
I mean, if I was playing a fast run, I'd probably think more scale.
Yeah,
scale.
Yeah, it's kind of more muscle sort of thing.
Yeah,
But I love the fact that you're able to name like the interval as you're playing it, like saying, "Oh, like it's a really." Little deliberate thought process, like, oh, I'm going to choose this interval because it's going to cause tension against the chord.
Yeah.
I definitely want to get better at that.
Yeah, I mean, that's part of that comes from listening to a lot of classical music. And there's a great, I don't know what sound I've got. No
you
sound
have
at all. Okay, let me just try and get a sound. I was listening to a piece by John Taverner, the composer who died recently, and he had this great key change. I'm not quite sure what key it was, but he had something like this. He had that note, and then resolved it to there.
Yes.
Have you heard?
So it's like it's flat ninth. So nice. So that'd be like an E flat over a D chord. Which sounds a bit weird, like some, but when it resolves, you suddenly think, oh, that's really nice.
Do you know the Ravel's piano concerto for left hand in G major?
Yeah.
The second movement, it's a really slow second movement, and he does the same thing. It's really dissonant.
Yeah.
And then just at the last second, it's resolved.
Yeah.
And you sit and the hairs on the back of your neck go up.
Yeah.
Because it is incredible, and it's also very dissonant in the upper register. and it sits underneath this cord, and it really makes you do this, and it's beautifully resolved, but it's very ugly in the initial instance. But
yes.
It creates a very, very specific effect.
Yes. Yeah.
That's not, because you can do all of that stuff in a jazz context, and it has a very specific sound, but it's this beautiful, beautiful harmony, and then suddenly, and then it comes back in again.
Yeah.
And it's absolutely stunning. I don't know if you've heard it, but...
Not for a long time, but
it's absolutely beautiful.
It's written for a guy who had his arm blown off in the war.
Oh, really?
Or something, I think. Did one arm.
Really? Yeah. Wow.
So, you were saying earlier, we're talking about using the bouzouki and then playing chords and using open strings to create sort of dissonance as well.
You guys should definitely do the bouzouki. We've got about 10 minutes left.
Oh. Ask a quick question about composition. This might go on to you as well. Maybe you. I don't really compose as such, but I've been listening to, as I do often on the way here, like podcasts, and they're usually comedian-based, and they sort of talk about writing and stuff. And some of them have things where they will only kind of write when they're inspired, but some of them will say, right, they kind of do the... It's like the Roald Dahl thing where they go, right, I'm going to do 2 hours of just composing or writing or whatever, just every morning, go and do 2 hours, and then come back to it later. Now, do you guys sort of only write when the mood takes you, or do you just kind of sit down and just sort of set aside that time to try and, you know, something out, but...
For me, it's I need, once I've got an idea for a kind of album or project... Then I'll start quite intensively.
You're sort of like chasing it then.
Yeah, but other than that, like with this, I've spent weeks sort of getting this ready for live performance.
Right.
So I tend to go through. I mean, I'm always thinking about sort of new ideas and ways of doing stuff. And
I know some people say they've always got music in
their head.
Yeah,
so I have stuff that I hear all the time. So. So I tried to fairly regularly commit some of that, and some of it's rubbish, you know, but some of the songs off my album all came in one go, but a lot of them were just things that I just try and catch, so I put a sort of morning a week aside to try and come up with stuff.
Right.
Yeah.
Do you have a ton of stuff on your hard drive then that never gets finished?
Yeah, I've got a load. When I did Celestial Fire, the last album, I think there was about 40 ideas, so I've still got about 20 or something, still in various stages of being finished.
Right, okay.
Some of which I'll work on definitely for the next album.
Right, so you've got even more material lined up.
Yes, yeah, yes, yes.
So, are you guys going to do the bouzouki number?
Yeah,
so this is the bouzouki, tuned in at the moment in fifths.
It's like,
it doesn't half sound good.
Violin, mandolin, kind of.
Yeah, G, D, A, E, so... Yeah, like a mandolin, but
upside down guitar.
Yeah.
With octave strings on the lower two and then double strings on the higher two. Yeah.
What we're going to play here, this is a tune, it's the main theme from one of the pieces of the Celestial Fire album. One of the things I wanted to do with the bouzouki part on this was like have a drone of the top two strings going all the way through the chords. And it's almost like a drone in reverse rather than in the bass, you have it at the top. And then that creates a nice sort of tension when the chords sort of go past. So occasionally you get notes that are like extensions of the basic harmony sort of thing.
Awesome.
Okay. 1, 2, 3, 4. Thank you.
It's superb. The bouzouki sounds amazing.
It's a great instrument. Yeah, I've been playing this. I got this in 1997.
Right.
But before that, we did an Iona album called Journey into the Morn, and I borrowed a mandola to do some of the parts, which is quite a similar instrument. Mm. And loved the sound, and then got this one from Roger Bucknell at Filed in Penrith.
Yeah, my dad used to have a Filed guitar.
Oh, yes, yeah. They're great. I've got a Filed guitar, bouzouki, and mandolin. Right.
Yeah.
So,
very nice.
Yeah, got the whole family.
Fantastic. Did you want to play anything else actually from the album? Because we haven't got that long left, so depends what you guys want to do in terms of prioritising things. Because now we've got him, we might as well get done what you guys want to do. So what would you like to...
How about having a jam?
Yeah, absolutely.
One of the things that we've always done in Iona, originally it was me and Dave Fitzgerald, and then Troy on the pipes, and then with Frank, who plays violin, Well, start off playing a tune, but then improvise the rest of the whole thing. So I improvise all the harmonies. Basically, we just follow each other and just see where it led.
Were there ever any dodgy moments?
Oh, occasionally there are, yeah.
Because there will be now.
Yeah, but that's the...
Live without a safety net.
Yeah, absolutely.
But sometimes there are some sublime moments. And,
of course, yeah.
Yeah.
That's the nature of it, I guess. And that's why it's fun. So the deal here is that Dave is going to be providing the harmony. I've no idea what he's going to play, and I'm going to have to try and play over the top of it. It's actually similar, bringing it back around to something me and you talked about, an ear training exercise that Dan and I talked about, where Dan was playing random chords, and I mean they really, really were random.
Yeah, I mean we try and be a little bit fair and not play any like weird, you know, little quartal modal things that
a
could
string
be anything,
of melodic minor
you know.
Chords.
Yeah, you try and make it, you know, relatively obvious, but still unrelated, you know. Mm.
Let's have a little bit more keyboard for me. Just play again, Dave.
Oh, sorry.
Yeah,
we do this tune in Iona called Ruach, which is basically a keyboard and violin improvisation. And we've got a bit of a tune that starts in D minor at the beginning.
I'm glad you've told me where we're starting.
We segue it into a tune with like a vocal song, which is in G minor.
Okay.
So basically we have to get from D minor to G minor, but via wherever.
Something that happens in the middle.
Yeah, but I'm not going to do that now, though. But,
Great.
But we can start with the D.
That's fine. Yeah.
Thank you.
fun.
Yeah, to improvise around that note at the end, because the last, yeah.
Yeah, they stuck notes. All right, thank you very much. That was cool, good fun.
Yeah, excellent. Have to do that again sometime.
Absolutely. So, anything else you guys want to play just to finish with, or anything you want to cover?
What's the horrible 11 name?
You want me to play that, do you?
What about a bit of the storm?
Yeah.
This is a tune which is a real. This is originally a Moving Hearts tune. That's an Irish band. just do the first bit of it.
Yeah.
But it's a two-part reel. This one. Well, there's two reels actually. The first one has got two different parts, and then the
reel
second,
to reel.
Yes.
Reel to reel.
Again.
The second one's got three parts. I don't know if we'll get that far, but we'll see. So we'll start with the tune. Yeah. Two, three.
Beautiful and technically amazing. You know, those reels work so well on guitar.
Yeah, they do. Yes.
Well, I mean, but it's distorted guitar. You know, loads of gain, electric guitar.
Yes,
it's phenomenal.
Yeah, particularly when you hear it with pipes as well or whistle. It's really
very addictive sound.
Yes.
Awesome.
But it also gets you out of the shapes that you normally play on guitar as well.
Yeah. I just need to practice my picking. It's a nightmare. All right. Well. Thank you so much for joining us, Dave.
Thanks, Dave.
I'm going to take you up on the offer of a jam at some point.
Yeah, absolutely.
It's just been a pleasure having you here. Fascinating and just beautiful music. Thank you so much. Let me just really quickly show you these again. So, Dave Bainbridge, Celestial Fire. Make sure you buy that album. It's absolutely fantastic. And there's Iona albums. So this is Veil of Gossamer.
That's my album.
That's a solo.
Here's the Iona album. Sorry. That's your album, Veil of Gossamer.
Yeah.
So is this the previous
album? Yeah, that was my first solo album.
When did this come out?
2004.
And then this is the Iona album, Edge of the World. This is the live album.
Really good.
So these are all available from iona.uk.com. And then your website. I actually bought Celestial Fire from your website.
Right.
Thanks so much for your incredible content in the chat window as well. Hilarious. So check out the albums, check out Dave's playing. Mr. Bronze as well. Dave Bronze, Dave joins us every week on the stream, and you have to check out Dave's album. Have you got Dave's album?
Oh,
somewhere?
It's in my case.
Oh, there. He's took it away.
No, that's all
the name of your album, Mr. Bronze?
Based on a True Story.
And it is unbelievably good. Both of these albums are incredible. Right, guys, so we're going to say thanks to Dave and Dan one more time. I'm Tom Quayle. Thank you for watching the Guitar Hour, guys. I'm not sure when we're going to be back. We'll have to figure that one out. Certainly, probably, we'll maybe do one next week. We'll figure it out. Because I'm off to Spain very soon, and you guys are on tour.
Yeah.
So that's going to be very difficult for Mr. Bronze. And when we get Mr. BB back on, we'll see what's happening. But thanks again, guys, and we will see you next time. Thank you so much.
Cheers.
Bye-bye.